Hello everyone, good morning. Today is 10th of November. My name is Sahil and welcome to the newspaper analysis. Friends, into the video, we will be taking up today the entire analysis of the Hindu newspaper. We will be taking up today the articles from the Indian Express explained section also if they are important. And guys, the PDF for the articles that we are going to discuss, you can download it from our Telegram channel. The link has been given into the description. Now friends, starting up first of all with the overview of the newspaper articles. So first of all, this is the Indian Express explained section, and the first article, it is talking about the NSA's agenda onto the Afghanistan. So guys, already into the yesterday's the Hindu newspaper, this particular news we have covered, where we have seen that the National Security Advisor of India, he is convening the meeting with the NSAs of the countries such as the Iran, countries such as the Russia, as well as the Central Asian countries. The Pakistan as well as China were also invited, but they did not came. So basically that particular thing has again been repeated. Nothing new substance has been there. Already these things we have taken up yesterday. After that, the below article, it is talking about how Srinagar earned UNESCO creative tag. So guys, yesterday we have seen that the UNESCO had included the city of Srinagar into the creative city network. So we have seen that why it has been there and all these kind of things. So again, the same thing have been repeated. Then guys, this particular side article, it is talking about the climate change performance index. We'll be seeing this particular thing. It is an important article for our exam. Then further moving on, after that we reach to the Hindu newspaper, page number 1. And here the first article we can see that the Ministry of Home Affairs tasked to monitor foreign funds for NGOs. Why it has been done? This has been asked by the Supreme Court. So why this particular controversy is coming, all the background, etc. We'll be seeing it. After that, rain lets up but woes of Chennai continue. So guys, recently because of the untimely rain, incessant rains that have been there into the Chennai, the water logging has been there, and because of that particular thing, the people are stranded and all such kind of things are there. It shows the failure of the urban planning. Then further moving on guys, after that, monitoring Chinese assets into the Indian Ocean. So we will be seeing this particular article, what it is talking about. Then the below articles are not very much important for our examination. Please ignore it. Then guys, further moving on into the city section, basically the regional issues, etc. has been mentioned. You don't need to go into this particular thing. Much of the relevant substance is not there into these particular articles. So guys, then further we'll be moving on in between the advertisement, etc. are they are not at all important for our paper. Then guys, here we can see that into the Supreme Court, the matter had went where the Kerala is asking that the Muleppariyar Dam needs to be reconstructed. Guys, earlier we have taken up this particular controversy. This is just a concept that the Muleppariyar River, which is being actually operated by the Tamil Nadu, but it is into the Kerala. This particular dam is more than 125 years old, and there are the reports that this particular dam has been structurally damaged, and into the near future it can completely break up, and by into that particular capacity the entire region into the nearby river it will be flooded. So therefore this particular dam needs to be again reconstructed. This particular thing has been provided by the Kerala. So just that concept. Fine. After that guys, moving on into the editorial section, we'll see that the first article in UP, missing Tango and the BJP vault. So political article, not important for our exam. This particular article talking about the life course immunization. So with respect to immunization, some good insights have been taken. We'll see it. Then this article, it is talking about the India and Pakistan, as their relations are deteriorating, the heat is being faced by the fishermen. We'll see this particular article. Then guys, the UP police are making heavy weather of task of probing farmer deaths fairly. So basically the UP police's role into the farmer death into the Lakhimpur Kheri and all these kind of things have been discussed. Then after that, India must remain safe for diversity. So this particular article is a book excerpt from a book written by Shashi Tharoor. So a brief idea of important things will be taking up from this particular article. Then there are shades of equality. So it is talking about recent direction that has been given by Supreme Court for the Kerala High Court, particularly in respect to the reservation scholarships. So we'll be seeing this particular matter under the lens of affirmative action. Then the cost of BJP's tug of war, not important article for your exam. Then guys, further moving on, Kisan Morcha takes its fight and all these things, guys, not important. Fine. Supreme Court transfers clears transfer of Madras High Court CJ to the Meghalaya. Fine, you don't need to see all the judges who are being transferred and all these kind of things. Guys, such a questions will not be there into the examination. Then further that, we can see here that GMC to forge solution to key issues. So basically the Goa Maritime Conclave and the things that are coming into the Indian Ocean, etc. are being talked here. We will be seeing all these particular things. Then further moving on guys, NSA Doval meets Tajik Uzbek counterpart. So this is the meet that has happened. Then further moving on, J&K hospital gets faulty ventilator. Nothing important into this particular direction is there. Then guys, the China exports warship to the Pakistan to be deployed into the Indian Ocean. So with respect to the Indian Ocean vulnerabilities, we will be taking up this particular entire article. Fine. After that, guys, moving on into this particular thing, onto the business page. Here we can see that the supply chains of manufacturing is leaving the Asia. So basically a reversal of the supply chain from Asia to again the Europe, etc. is going on. So we will analyze this particular thing. Then, guys, the corporate news, etc. you don't need to see. After that, we come to the sports page. So that is all, guys, about the overview of the important articles. Now let's see all these articles one by one into the detail. Now, starting up, first of all, we will be taking the GS quote for today. So today's GS quote, we will be taking from the Kofi Annan, the former United Nations Secretary General. He says, suffering anywhere concerns people everywhere. Guys, it is very similar to the idea that the justice, injustice anywhere concerns the people everywhere. So if even a minuscule section of the people are suffering, that particular thing shows the underachievement of the humanity as a whole. It shows the failure of the government and the failure of the social justice principle as a whole. So even if a minuscule people are suffering, the state actions are needed to be taken to ensure the social justice, to ensure the welfareism for those people. So basically, guys, this is the idea. Okay, you can use it into the GS paper number 4, empathy and compassion for the people, as well as in GS paper number 2 also you can use this particular idea. So that is all. Now let's take the first article. Okay, the first article we have taken from the Indian Express explained section, and guys, this particular article talks about the climate change performance index 2021 that has been recently released. Now this particular article you can use into the answers related to the GS paper number 3, environment, ecology and conservation. Now let's discuss this thing. Guys, basically this climate change performance index, it is released by principally by the Green Watch, which is an NGO working for the environmental conservation, and it is based in the Germany. And basically this Green Watch, in cooperation with two other NGOs, that is the New Climate Institute and the Climate Action Network, combinedly releases this particular climate change performance index report. Now guys, into this particular report, actually the 57 countries as well as European Union, their performance has been measured, that what are the steps that they are taking in order to fulfill their intended nationally determined contribution. Now guys, the intended nationally determined contributions were the targets taken by the countries in 2015 in Paris, where they have taken up basically self-affirmed target that okay, we will be doing this in order to reduce the emission, in order to reverse the climate change, etc. India has also taken the INDC target, and guys, recently into the COP26 that has held into the Glasgow, India had even revised its INDC target, okay, and the 5 enhancements we have done into our targets. Now, it is seen that whether the countries are doing good onto their INDC, and whether by 2030, the countries will able to achieve their INDCs or not. Onto this parameter, the countries are judged. Now guys, into this particular index, there are actually the 14 indicators and the 4 categories. These categories are the global house gas emissions, what is the country doing, 40% weightage is given to it. Then renewable energy, it is also given 20% weightage. Then energy usage, okay, whether it is efficient or not. Okay, then the climate policy, into the climate policy, the climate diplomacy, the state actions, legislative actions, etc., all these kind of things are included. Okay, now guys, this particular year's climate change performance index of 2021 is little bit different. Why? Because guys, the rank, it starts from the 4th rank. The rank number 1, 2 and 3 has not been given to any of the country, because it has been said that none of the country has not done sufficient that it can be given the first 3 ranks. So the rank starts from the 4th, and the 4th rank has actually been given to the Sweden. And guys, India has performed also really well, and here we can see that actually India has been given the 10th rank, and the score of India is 63.98, which is a very good score. So basically this particular thing shows that guys, India is actually following the climate diplomacy, climate action into a conscious manner. Now guys, what is the thing which had favored India the most? India has been favored because the per capita emission of India are very much low. Though India is third largest emitter into the world, but per capita emission are low because the population is very much high, and because of that particular capacity, India becomes a kind of a performer. Now guys, in basically all the three categories, that is the ग्रीन हाउस गैस एमिशन कैटेगरी, एनर्जी यूज कैटेगरी एंड क्लाइमेट पॉलिसी कैटेगरी इंडिया हैज बीन द हाई परफॉर्मर। हाउएवर इन टू दिस पर्टिकुलर कैटेगरी दैट इज द रिन्यूएबल एनर्जी कैटेगरी, दो इंडिया हैड टेकन एम्बिशियस टारगेट्स, फॉर एग्जांपल 175 गीगावाट ऑफ रिन्यूएबल एनर्जी बाय 2022, 500 गीगावाट ऑफ रिन्यूएबल एनर्जी बाय 2030। Ambitious targets are there, but still, onto the renewable energy category, India has been the medium performer, not the high performer. And guys, when we talk about the countries such as the USA, USA has been ranked at the bottom of this particular index. Saudi Arabia and USA, they are ranking at the bottom of this particular index. Okay, so that allegation that USA always imposes onto the India, that India is not doing much for the climate change and all those kind of things, are not completely justified as per the climate change performance index of 2021. Please guys, use this particular reference into the answers when you are writing onto the GS paper number 3, environment ecology. So that is all about this particular article. I hope guys you have understood all these aspects, and now we'll move to the next article. Okay, now this particular article taken from the first page of the Hindu newspaper, and this article, the Supreme Court is asking that why MHA, Ministry of Home Affairs, is monitoring the foreign funding of the NGOs. This particular article will be important into our GS paper number 2, where clearly the role of NGOs, self-help groups has been mentioned. So GS paper number 2, role of NGO, evolution of NGOs, performance of NGO, we will be using it. First of all guys, before going into this particular article, I would like to tell you some of a background without which you might not be able to understand this article's gravity. See guys, actually what had happened in 2020, the government came out with an amendment into the FCRA, that is the Foreign Contribution Regulation Act. Now the FCRA is a principal act which governs the foreign funding. Okay, if a money is being transferred by a foreign agency into the India, this particular legislation works under this. Now it has been provided that the non-government organizations, fine, they might receive the funding from the foreign companies, foreign people, but they have to follow this FCRA. Okay, so under the FCRA, the NGOs, they have to take a license, and only the NGOs who have been licensed under FCRA, they can receive the funding. Now, basically, these are the changes that have been there. First of all, let's see them. Number one change that was made into the last year, it was provided that public sector employees, they cannot receive any foreign funding. Okay, that is a good kind of a thing, as they are doing into the public sector, the government can govern that, fine. Then guys, the other thing is that it has been provided that there cannot be any transfer of funds received under the FCRA to the other organization. Let's say guys that there is one big organization into the India, NGO, it has received the funding. This NGO cannot give it to any other person or to any other small NGO, etc. Now this particular point was highly criticized. It was said that there are actually the NGOs, self-help groups who are working at the grassroots. There are the Adivasi people, there are the scheduled caste people who need urgently money for their welfare mechanisms, and NGOs into the past, by receiving the foreign funding, had directly provided money to them, and they had worked very much good. Many of the reports have attributed that the NGOs has brought the social change. Now you had banned that the NGO cannot transfer the money to people or to other organization. Many of the small NGOs, small self-help groups will be completely wiped out. They will be killed. This is the provision that was criticized. After that guys, next it was provided that the administrative expenses, okay, of an NGO should not be more than the 20%. Okay, now what this particular thing means, let's suppose that the NGO had received 100 rupees from a foreign source. Now this particular money, it can spend as an administrative expense, and it can spend it as the field expense. Field expense is that actually work they are doing onto the ground, administrative expense for official purpose, etc. So it has been said that maximum of the money that you can use for administrative expense just could be 20%. Now, basically guys, all the NGOs are not working into the field. Some of the NGOs are the think tanks, okay, where they are actually analyzing the government actions, they are analyzing the government policies. So for them, only expenditure is the administrative expenditure. Now you had limited the administrative expenditure just to 20%. So many of those academic NGOs, think tank type of NGOs, NGOs which are analyzing the government policies, actions, they will not be able to sustain. This particular thing was there. After that, it was provided that providing Aadhaar number needs to be mandatory for all the office bearers who are the functionaries of an NGO. Now, this particular thing, guys, not onto the face is wrong, but it shows a level of distrust that is there. Then, guys, it was provided that the government has a power to suspend the FCRA registration of an NGO, okay, and even up to 180 days, this particular license could be cancelled. Now, guys, using this particular provision, actually, into the past, thousands of the NGOs' license has been cancelled, and many a times of the NGO are saying that into an arbitrary manner, even when NGO is raising some credible points, their licenses are cancelled. So, this particular provision is there. Then, it has been provided that after every 5 years, the NGO's FCRA registration is to be renewed, and after every 5 years, when it will be renewed, it will be just the scrutiny will happen into the case as it is a new NGO. Okay, so entire process is to be repeated at every 5 years. So it has been said that it will increase the burden. Then, guys, next, it has been provided that for an NGO to receive the money, okay, an FCRA designated account is to be opened into the State Bank of India branch into the Delhi, the headquarter branch of the SBI in Delhi. Okay. So now this particular thing has been there, guys, that actually the NGOs who are working into the other parts of the country, let's say NGOs working into the Kerala, for that particular NGO to come and open an operative account into the SBI in Delhi might be a problematic thing. And then voluntary surrendering of FCRA certificate could also be there. So basically, guys, it has been provided by these particular kind of amendments. Actually, the foreign funding of the NGO has been completely killed. Now, because of this particular matter was there, guys, what happened? Many of the NGOs, they had petitioned into the Supreme Court that this particular kind of thing is not into the right spirit. Okay, and now the Supreme Court had given the direction into this particular matter. But what the Supreme Court had said, that Supreme Court has said that why? Now, one more thing, guys, under the FCRA Act, who is the nodal agency who will supervise that whether the NGO are following it or not? Who will keep an eye on to the NGO? It is the Ministry of Home Affairs. Please keep it into the mind. Now, the Supreme Court has asked the Ministry of Home Affairs that why you have been tasked to keep an eye on to all these inflows, outflows of the foreign funding onto the NGO. Why this particular task has not been given to the Ministry of Finance or the Department of Finance? Why Ministry of Home Affairs has been given? Because Ministry of Home Affairs is more given the task to ensure the law and order into the internal boundaries and all such kind of things. Now, guys, into this capacity, Ministry of Home Affairs has given a justification. It has been said that according to the Intelligence Bureau, okay, it has been provided that many of the foreign funding that are entering into the India, they are being used to fund the activities that destabilize the national peace and security of India. Even the funding, foreign funding is being used to train the Naxalist, to train the Maoist. So therefore, this particular foreign funding becomes a matter of the internal security. So therefore, the Ministry of Home Affairs is looking into this particular thing. Now, guys, if I told you about this particular Intelligence Bureau report point, guys, actually, in 2014, there was a report published by the Intelligence Bureau into which it was provided that every year 1.5% to 2% of India's GDP has been suffered because certain NGOs are deliberately taking up certain activities where they are stalling the development. For example, the Narmada Bachao Andolan, okay, and many such kind of initiatives where they are campaigning against the developmental thing. So they said that is a vested agenda of the NGOs that they wanted to reduce the development of India, and they are working against the state. So therefore, Ministry of Home Affairs said that it is very much important to control NGO to see their funding. Moreover, it has also been provided that earlier the government did not had any way of knowing the inflow and outflow of the foreign funds. But now, in order to rectify that particular mistake, in order to keep a strict oversight vigilance, these amendments have been made, and the MHA, Ministry of Home Affairs, has been given a task. It is not a wrong. Now, guys, ultimate decision by the Supreme Court has not been given. This particular matter has been evolved. So into the few days, the Supreme Court will be coming out with final judgment, and then we'll see that ultimately what will happen here. So up till now, guys, this is the way into which this entire matter has been unfolded. So that is all about it. I hope you understood. Now we'll move to the next article. Now, guys, here actually we have clubbed the three articles, okay, together. One article, monitoring Chinese assets into the Indian Ocean, GMC to forge solutions to the key issues, and the China exports warship to the Pakistan to be deployed into the Indian Ocean. Actually, they are the part and parcel of only one thing only. Now, guys, first of all, I will tell you the background that what is happening, and then we will be moving into this particular article. Right now, the Goa Maritime Conclave has been there. Okay, into this particular Goa Maritime Conclave, what has been the case? बेसिकली इंडियन नेवी इट इज होस्टिंग द चीफ्स ऑफ द 12 कंट्रीज हु आर इन टू द इंडियन ओशन रीजन. ओके, सो बेसिकली द 12 नेशंस चीफ आर बींग होस्टेड एंड द थीम ऑफ दिस गोवा मैरिटाइम कॉन्क्लेव इज द मैरिटाइम सिक्योरिटी एंड इमर्जिंग नॉन ट्रेडिशनल थ्रेट्स अ केस फॉर प्रोएक्टिव रोल ऑफ इंडियन ओशन रीजन. दिस इज द थीम. ओके, येस्टरडे ऑल्सो एंड डे बिफोर येस्टरडे ऑल्सो बिफोर दैट ऑल्सो वी हैव सीन दिस पर्टिकुलर आर्टिकल. नाउ गाइज, इन टू दिस गोवा मैरिटाइम कॉन्क्लेव इट हैज बीन प्रोवाइडेड दैट ऑल द नेवीज इन टू द इंडियन ओशन रीजन दे नीड टू बी ब्रॉट टूगेदर सो दैट दे कैन लुक इन टू द कॉमन चैलेंजेस एंड दे कैन फाइंड द सोल्यूशन टू द कॉमन challenges. Now, what are the common challenges that have been discussed here? Challenge number one, the assertive role of the China. Guys, it has been provided that the People Liberation Army of China now is maintaining their base into the Djibouti and they are building the ships faster than anyone else. And according to a Pentagon report, yesterday I told you that by 2020, 60 to 70 warships the China will be maintaining. Even the submarines, sorry, they will be maintaining, and even the China is working on to the nuclear capable submarines, warships, etc. And many of them are being stationed into the Indian Ocean region. And today, Indian Ocean region has become the most important because, guys, the important communication lanes, important trade lanes, fine pass from the Indian Ocean region. And into the Indian Ocean region, as India is a strategic partner, and if Chinese presence will increase here, automatically the India's role will be diluted. So therefore the PLA's role is to be seen. Moreover guys, PLA, the China fine has been a kind of an aggressive nation. We see into the neighborhood that China has a dispute with all the maritime bond countries. Now if the China's presence will increase, other strategic partners countries will also be impacted. So this is the number one common challenge that has been there. After that guys, the next challenge that has been there, it is the narco terrorism. Now what is the narco terrorism? Narco terrorism means basically, for example, into the Afghanistan, now the situation has been changed and many of the terrorist organizations, they are growing the narcotics, they are growing the drugs, they are using that particular drugs, they are smuggling that to another countries, they are procuring the money and from that money they are buying the arms, okay, and by buying the arms they are leading to the terrorism and all such kind of things. Guys, it has been provided that there is a drug there is a connection between the drug trafficking and the arms trafficking. Basically the ISIS Khorasan is a terrorist organization. What it does, it is earning the money from the drugs trade. So basically the link of the drugs, it is like this. See guys, this is the Makran coast. Okay, focus onto this particular map. This is the Makran coast. So from Makran coast, the drugs, they flow to the east coast of Africa. Okay, from there, the drugs flow to the island countries such as the Maldives, fine, such as the other island countries. And from there, these drugs flow to Sri Lanka, then they come to the India. Into this particular manner, the drugs are flowing to the all the region into this particular vicinity. So therefore, this narco terrorism is also the emergent threat and it needs to be curtailed. Okay, these are the key takeaways from this Goa Maritime Conclave that has happened. Now, guys, into this capacity, what are actually the steps taken by the India? Let's see that one by one. Number one, India is working on to the Malabar and Quad. Now guys, Malabar and Quad, Malabar started in the 1990s when India and USA, they started to participate into the exercise, naval exercise. After that guys, into the Malabar, other countries have also been joined. Today into the Malabar, there is the USA, Australia, Japan and India, and into the quadrilateral security dialogue also the same four countries are there. So basically four countries are working that how into the Indo-Pacific, Indian Ocean region, the security and stability can be ensured. So how to counter the China? That particular part is being taken by the Malabar and Quad initiative. Another thing is that India has signed the foundational agreement with the USA. So basically guys, there are the four foundational agreements that the USA signs with any country, and all the four foundational agreements, they have been signed. Okay. And after that, the logistic support agreement have also been signed with the other countries also, such as the Australia. Now, how India signing these logistic agreement and foundational agreement will be helping the region? Basically, guys, what are the logistic agreement? First of all, you need to understand it. Let's suppose that there is a Indian ship. Now, the Indian ship is docking, let's say, in some part into the middle of the Indian Ocean, or let's say it is docking around the Guam or around the Australia. It will need fuel, it will need supplies, it will need basic provisions. Now, by signing the logistic agreement with any other country, for example, with the USA, with the Australia, they can take from the fuel from there, they can take the food from there, and they can continue their operations for a longer period of time. Now, as the India is signing all these kind of agreements, for a long period, India can stay posted into the oceans. And by that particular thing, India can preserve the security and the stability of not only India, but all the other countries as well. So by this particular way also, India is working for the stability of the region as a whole. After that, guys, what has by this particular things, what will happen? Even the reach and sustenance of the Navy will be enhanced, and the reach and sustenance is the most important goal of the Navy. Fine. Then what has been done since 2017, the Indian Navy had also started the new mission based deployment, that is the MBD. Now, what is the mission based deployment? Basically, not even when the war has been started, not even the crisis has been started, but already the deployment of the Navy naval vessels will be made into the strategic waters, so that in case into the future, if the crisis comes, if the war comes, they are very much ready to give the response. So the mission based deployment had started since 2017, and already the Navy's vessels have been deployed into the strategic areas. That is the thing by which actually the vigilantism is being shown, by which the military is showing the kind of a readiness into the Indian Ocean region and preserving the regional peace and security. Now guys, see this particular article, this one. Now what has happened here, we can see that the China had exported the warship to the Pakistan. Okay, and the warship that has been delivered by China to Pakistan, it is the Type 054A frigate. Okay, and guys, it is one of the most capable, one of the most advanced warship that the China had provided to any country. And which country? The Pakistan. Now the credentials of Pakistan and Pakistani army has been a lot disputed, and into that capacity, whether the Pakistan will be using this particular warship for good intentions or not, it is not clearly known. Pakistan has named this particular ship as the PNS Tugril. Okay, and this particular warship can be used against even the Indian interest. So by these particular things, the vigilantism into the region is needed, and the country is needed to take a responsible approach here. So now India had concluded the Goa Maritime Conclave, where the countries are being brought together and they are discussing their strategy. That is all, guys, the things that has been there. I hope that you have understood it. And now we'll move to the next article. Okay. Now, this particular article taken from the Hindu newspaper, India must remain safe for diversity. Guys, what this particular article is? This article is an excerpt taken from a book written by the Shashi Tharoor, and the name of the book is the Pride, Prejudice and Punditry. Okay, Pride, Prejudice and Punditry. Now, into this particular book, the idea of diversity, idea of India's soft power, and actually the Jawaharlal Nehru's vision for the India has been talked about. Guys, you don't need to go too much into this particular thing, but some of the key idea from this particular book, we will be taking it up. Now, basically, it has been provided that into the India, fine, always India had worked onto its skilled power. Fine, it has been said that basically the Jawaharlal Nehru was the skilled exponent of the soft power. Basically, there are two concepts. There is the soft power and there is a hard power. The idea of soft power for the first time was given by the thinker Joseph Nye. Into the soft power, he says that many a times countries can influence the other countries because of their traditions, because of their heritage, because of their values. Okay, so a power to attract the other country without the weapons is called as the soft power. So India's soft power has been enhanced greatly by the Jawaharlal Nehru. It has been said basically by the civilizational history of India, by the moral standing of India, India, by making it the voice of the oppressed and the marginalized country, India had promoted its soft power. Guys, here we go, let's go beyond this particular article. Take the example of the non-alignment movement NAM. Now, what was the NAM? Into the NAM, India took a viewpoint that we will not be aligning with any of the camp, neither will we go with USSR nor will be going with the USA. We will be making an independent foreign policy, and the countries who were getting the new independence, they were all brought up into the NAM. So what happened? India at that point of time did not went for the power politics. Rather, India took the weak countries, oppressed countries, and make a kind of a coalition. So by this particular thing, India had shown its kind of a soft power. India had developed a kind of a good standing. Moreover, by the civilizational history, rich history, okay, India has always achieved a very good positive soft power. Now guys, it has been provided that even into the information age, India is not having the policy that it sides with the bigger army or with the more powerful. Rather, India sides with the country which had a better story to tell. Okay, so into that particular capacity, even India gives a free enterprise, free press, free media, free speech of expression to their people. And by that thing also, into the India, India's soft power has been increased. And guys, this particular precedence was started by the Jawaharlal Nehru. So basically this particular tradition is continuing. Now it has been said that basically into the recent few years, India had gone a kind of a transformation in many of the things. For example, into the politics a transformation has been there, into the economics transformation has been there, into the economy we started with the kind of a socialism, okay, from that socialism we converted to the mixed economy, and from that mixed economy now we are going toward the free enterprise, okay. So by this particular thing, the economic system has been changed. Earlier there was the deglobalization, then globalization, and after the globalization, now is coming the Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan. So economic transformation has been there, social transformation has been there. A rigid hierarchical caste system was there, by which egalitarian system was developed, where the lowest caste, they were given the importance, okay. Secular political culture got developed, okay. Even into the secular political culture, one political party which is dominating, which is showcasing a particular religion, it is ruling. So basically onto the social level a lot of change has happened. Fine. Now guys, it has been said that if so many of the transformations or change would have happened in some another country, up till now that particular country would have went into a kind of a crisis. And guys, the example also we see that wherever any kind of change comes, a transformation comes, a crisis comes. But in India, the changes come, but rather than the crisis, we have absorbed that particular changes. The bloody revolutions have not happened. And why that particular thing has not happened? Because of the rich credentials, the strong base that has been created into the India by the leaders such as the Jawaharlal Nehru. So basically guys, this particular thing has been provided as an idea into this particular book, that is The Pride, Prejudice and Punditry, written by the Shashi Tharoor. Okay, so this is all about it. Apart it from it, nothing is there into this particular article. And now we'll be moving guys into the next article. Now India needs to sign up for the life course immunization. So this article taken from the Hindu, and guys, with respect to the GS paper number 2, public health, this particular article will be important. Now let's see this particular article, what it says. So basically guys, it has been provided that when we talk about the vaccines, okay, vaccines have always been used for the wider age population. For every person, the vaccine has been important, from a 1 year child to the 90 year old person, okay. And after the smallpox, this particular thing was prevalent also. However guys, the moment smallpox was eradicated and the expanded program for immunizations got started into the countries, what happened? The thinking into the countries got changed. It was believed that the vaccination is more important for the children, because guys, around this particular time of late 1970s and late 1980s, children were being focused for the vaccine. And now the reason is there that why children are being focused for the vaccine, because it has been provided that if the vaccine is provided into the early part of a life, then a person develops a better immunity against many kind of diseases. So the vaccine was preferred to the children, and over the period of time a thinking came that vaccine is only important for the children. This particular thing has been there. Now guys, the COVID-19 vaccines came as an exception into this particular thinking, because the first priority for the COVID-19 vaccine was given to the old people, then the middle-aged people, and into the last the children are being talked about. So this particular thing is coming. Now it has been said that guys, actually the vaccination is the most cost-effective public health intervention, okay, because at the later times the hospital admission etc. will not be there if the vaccine has been given. But still, into the India as well as into the world, there is large vaccine inequities that are existing. Fine. For example, the coverage of children has not happened. The coverage onto the basis of geography is low. Gender, parents' education, family socioeconomic systems, they have become a kind of a filters which have provided inequity into the vaccination. So therefore guys, it has been provided that now India needs to work onto the multi-vectorous approach, where the vaccination for the adult needs to be focused as well as for the children needs to be focused. And not only the COVID-19 vaccination we are talking about, many other vaccines, for example the vaccines for the pneumonia, vaccines for many other kind of diseases are also there, which have not been given to the adult people. But now the time has come that even adult people should be given those vaccines which have not earlier been given. So it has been said that the only national vaccine policy that we have, that particular vaccine policy was released in 2011. And this vaccine policy of India did not have any mention of the adult vaccination. So first of all, we need to change the policy. Now guys, there are actually the outside government, some पॉलिसीज आर देयर. फॉर एग्जाम्पल अ पॉलिसी हैज बीन रिलीज्ड बाय द एसोसिएशन ऑफ फिजिशियंस ऑफ इंडिया एंड इंडियन सोसाइटी ऑफ नेफ्रोलॉजी विच हैड टॉक्ड अबाउट द अडल्ट वैक्सीनेशन बट एज दीज आर द प्राइवेट रिकमेंडेशंस नो वन टेक्स इट. मोर ओवर गाइज इन टू द इंडियन वैक्सीनेशन प्रोग्राम गवर्नमेंट इज द मेजर वैक्सीनेटर. So therefore, a government policy for the adult vaccination is we need. After that, guys, it has been provided that there is a very limited data onto the burden of vaccine preventable diseases into the adult age people. Okay, basically there are certain diseases which could be prevented if the vaccine could have been given. How many of such cases are there? We don't have any data into this particular thing. Fine, guys, if I tell you, basically it has been provided that this particular thing has provided that into the children, less number of children die because of the pneumonia, but more old people die because of the pneumonia. Why? Because the children, they have been vaccinated for pneumonia, but old people have not been vaccinated for pneumonia. But how many people are dying? Such data is not there. So therefore, certain solutions or the way forward has been there. We'll be seeing all these way forward one by one. Number one, we need to take the initiatives to educate the people as well as the healthcare providers, professionals, what is the importance of the adult age vaccine groups. Guys, we need to educate that today children are receiving the vaccines, but the people who were adult 20 years back, 30 years back, when the vaccines got introduced, they have never been covered under the vaccine umbrella. So the education to the health professionals, people, is needed to be given. Training programs are to be organized. Even into the graduate and postgraduate teaching curriculum, the adult vaccination needs to be taught. Then the next thing that has been provided here is that basically the mandate of the National Technical Advisory Group onto the immunization needs to be expanded. Now guys, this NTAGI, National Technical Advisory Group, it has played a very important role into the COVID-19 vaccination. More than 108 crore vaccines we have given. So this organization, the scope for adult vaccination needs to be enhanced. Then VPD surveillance, that is the vaccine preventable disease surveillance, needs to be enhanced, and we need to report that how many people's disease could be prevented if they could have been given the vaccine. Then the capacity of research and academic institutions also needed to be enhanced so that the cost effective solution for the vaccination they can come out with. Then the next that thing has been provided, we need to develop the roadmap for adult vaccination policy. Fine, and that guys, finally we need to see, it has been provided that we also need to preserve the supply of the vaccines. Basically in 2019 what happened, the rabies vaccine was into a shortage, okay, and as the rabies vaccine was into the shortage, there was the problems that were created. So as many of the vaccines are now to be given to the adult population, all the vaccines from wherever they are coming, their source of supply needs to be preserved. The domestic capacity of India also needs to be enhanced so that majority of the vaccines can be produced. The APIs, that is the active pharmaceutical ingredients, that is the main component of the vaccine, needs to be preserved. That needs to be developed into the country so that even our reliance onto the country such as the China needs to be reduced. Because guys, many of the APIs, that is the main component of the vaccine, we take from the China. So we need to develop the reliance onto the supply also. So basically guys, it has been provided that childhood vaccination program has been best performing government health initiative into the India. Okay, basically even into the COVID-19, 93-95% of the vaccine shots have been provided by the government to the people. So basically the capacity is there already. We have proved into the child immunization that coverage can be provided. So now the scope needs to be expanded to the adult vaccination as a whole. That is all which has been provided into this particular article. And now guys, we'll move to the next article. Now, this article taken again from the Hindu newspaper, there are shades of equality. So basically guys, this particular article is mentioning about one of a judgment given by the Kerala High Court with respect to the scholarship that are given to the minority communities. Okay. Now, we will be understanding this particular issue. What is there? First of all, guys, before that, we understand the background of this article. So, guys, this particular story, it starts in 2015. What happened? In 2015, the Kerala government passed an executive order and it provided that the minority communities, they will be provided the scholarship so that effectively they can carry out with their education. It was provided that 80% of the scholarships, they were will be provided to the Muslim students, and 20% of the scholarship will be provided to the Latin Catholics as well as to the converted Christians. So these were the two categories to whom the scholarships were to be given. Now guys, the Kerala High Court into the Justin Pallavi Thukkal versus State of Kerala provided the that the government's approach is wrong. It said that what government did, it had said that 80% of vaccination will be given to the Muslims. No, that is wrong. Rather, as per the proportion of the every minority, you need to give them the scholarships. For example, if the proportion of Muslim is like 40%, give them only the 40% scholarship. If the proportion of Christians is like 30%, give them the 30%. So this 80-20 fixed ratio is not correct. You need to give them in on to the basis of their numbers. Now, government of Kerala argued this particular point, and they said that according to the Sachar committee report, as well as according to the Kerala Padana report, it has been provided that the Muslims are the most disadvantaged. It was provided that they are far behind than the Christians, Dalits and Adivasis. And it was provided that not only into the jobs, they face the discrimination, rather into many other social realms also, they face a lot of discrimination. So therefore, in order to uplift the Muslims, much more scholarships are to be provided to them. We cannot simply follow the rule of proportion here. Fine. So therefore, guys, now what had happened, this particular matter was appealed by the Kerala government into the Supreme Court, that the Kerala High Court is saying that give it according to proportion, but that thing will not be good. So the government appealed that particular thing in Supreme Court. Now Supreme Court had sent the notice to the Kerala High Court, and later words the Supreme Court will be giving the final judgment. Up till now the final judgment has not been given, but guys, here the opinion has been provided into the article. Now the opinion, it goes like this, that the Madras High Court, what it did, it prohibited an allocation onto the basis of the social realities. It followed a blind equality approach. Again, I'm repeating, the blind equality approach. But the blind equality approach cannot always bring the complete social justice. It has been provided that even it is not in the consonance with the constitutional and just vision of equality. It has been provided by the Supreme Court into the B.K. Pavitra versus Union of India case that for equality to be truly effective or substantive, the principle must recognize existing inequalities in society to govern them. Basically, equality doesn't mean that, for example, guys, let's see that there is a class. Okay, into this particular class, let's say there are the 50 students. Into these 50 students, 10 students are very much good, 20 students are like average, and then there are the other 20 students which are very much poor. So if the school decides that these 20 students who are average, we will provide them 1 hour extra class, and these 20 students who are poor into the studies, we will provide them the 2 hours extra class, you cannot say that the equality is not being followed. Why? Because to them you are giving 1 hour extra class, to them they are giving 2 hour extra class, and to these people you are not giving any extra class. You cannot say that the principle of fairness has been violated here. So there is a premise that some people will be given more preference, some people will be given less preference onto the basis of their social standing. So into that capacity, what the Kerala government had done, that was right. And the Kerala High Court, what it is suggesting, Kerala High Court is suggesting that you give to every person the fair kind of thing. So that could not be possible. So guys, into this particular capacity, it has been provided that even the B.R. Ambedkar provided that the core feature of caste system is in India is there is a graded inequality. Inequality is not equally spreaded. So as graded inequality is there, graded preference also is needed to be given. All these particular ideas have been provided. Fine. So guys, the idea, academic way, is important for you. You don't need to go too much into the hairline details, because at the end of the day it is a regional matter. So this particular idea of graded inequality, etc., you need to understand it. So that is all, guys. This particular article will be again important for the GS paper number 2, constitutional issues, political issues. Now we'll move to the next article. Now this particular article, taken from the Hindu newspaper, caught in the crossfire. Basically, guys, what this article is about, what had happened, basically an Indian fisherman has been killed by the Pakistan Maritime Security Agency around the coast of Gujarat onto the November 7th. Not important to keep in your mind the details, date, etc. Now guys, it has been provided that there is Pakistan and then there is India. The relation between the Pakistan and India are deteriorating, but the basically frustration of that particular thing, the Pakistan is releasing onto the poor fishermen, the fisherman has been killed. And into the last few years, not they have been killed, they have been arrested into the large number, their trawlers have been seized, etc. Guys, for example, into the April 2020, the Pakistani forces opened the fire onto the two boats of the coast of Gujarat, where one person was injured. In 2019, they sank one of the Indian boat into which seven fishermen were there. Okay, in into this particular capacity, guys, what the Pakistan is doing, Pakistan is showing their frustration of relations onto the poor fishermen, and even the arrest of the fishermen has been increased. According to the National Fishermen Fisher Workers Forum, there are 558 Indian fishermen who are into the Pakistani jails, and 74 from the Pakistan are there into the Indian prisons. Okay, the fishermen from both the countries are into the jail, but respectively, Pakistan has arrested large number of people. Moreover, guys, it has been provided that there are still 1200 Indian fishing vessels that are there into the Pakistan's custody. Now, guys, when the people are being arrested, okay, what you are doing? You are arresting a poor man just because he was trying to earn his livelihood. 1200 vessels are there. Basically, these are the vessels of the poor, vulnerable fishermen. So, by this particular thing, guys, a negative message is being given. So, countries need to adopt a more matured approach in dealing this particular matter, and the seizing of their weapons, arresting them, killing them is not a approach. Guys, it has been provided that basically the fishermen and these kind of matters erupt even between the friendly countries. For example, India is there and the Sri Lanka is there. With the India and Sri Lanka, the relations are good. But even the Sri Lanka and India, they many times arrest the fishermen, but they are released also. But the Pakistan is not understanding that particular thing. Guys, it has been provided that in 2007, actually, the Pakistan and India, they formed the Joint Judicial Committee, where the 8 retired judges from both the India and the Pakistan were organized, and it was said that the exchange of the civilian prisoners will be happened. So prisoners from Pakistan in Pakistan and in India, from each of our countries, they will be exchanged. But this particular program is defunct since 2013, and there were proposal to revive it in 2018 also, but this particular thing has again not been fructified. So therefore, we need to again establish such kind of a judicial committee for exchanging the civil prisoners, and the fishermen needs to be exchanged. And we need to understand that when the border is there, okay, around the borders, there will be certain people who will from time to time might venture out here and there unknowingly, or for their livelihood, or for some other kind of reasons. You need not to consider all them as terrorists. You need not to consider them all as a threat, but into a more matured and humanitarian way, we need to deal with this particular kind of matter. So that is the entire thing that has been there. Fine. However, guys, no need to go too much into the detail. Just this particular thought, you need to keep it into your mind. Now we'll move to the next article. Now, guys, snarled supply chains force manufacturing exodus from Asia. So there is one idea here into this particular article. What this idea is, before that, this particular article, guys, will be important into the GS paper number 3, that is the foreign trade. Okay, now, guys, 2 to 3 years back, okay, 3 years back, into the economic survey, okay, into the economic survey, there was a chapter, and the name of the chapter into the economic survey was the shoes to jeans manufacturing. Meant that India need to leverage the low cost manufacturing into the apparel sector, textile sector, as well as into the shoe manufacturing sector, because there are many of the foreign brands who are relocating their manufacturing facility into the Asia. There are the countries such as the Vietnam, countries such as the Bangladesh, Indonesia, etc., which are attracting this low-cost manufacturing into their country. Already, the China is a country which had first of all attracted the low-cost manufacturing in 90s, 80s. By that, the China developed the wealth, and now the China is developing the high-tech sectors. Okay, so the low-cost manufacturing should be attracted into the India, and it has come into these Vietnam, Bangladesh, Indonesia countries. Now, guys, this particular thing is changing. Why this particular thing is changing? Let's understand this thing. Guys, in 2020, what happened? The COVID-19 pandemic come. And because of this particular COVID-19 pandemic, extended lockdowns were imposed. Now, guys, though the lockdowns were imposed into the Asia, there are the countries where the case burden was very much high. So the countries such as the Vietnam, etc., they also imposed the lockdown. Now, guys, because of that particular thing, the supply of the products to the America, to the European country, got suspended. And by that particular thing, there was a shortage of supply there. And the American manufacturers, the European manufacturers, now are realizing this particular thing, that the reliance onto the Asian economies is not a right kind of a strategy, because now again the new waves of the COVID-19 pandemic will be coming. Again, the lockdown can be imposed into these countries, and again the supply of the goods will get impacted. So now, guys, what is happening? The strategy of relocating the industries to the Asia, where the manufacturing is cheap, where the labor is cheap. Now this particular policy is changing, and basically the manufacturers, they are now exiting out from Asia. They are going away from the Asia. Fashion and the shoe retailers, they are relocating to the Balkans, Latin America. They are moving to the Eastern Europe, and into this particular capacity, guys, what is happening? The rethinking into the globe spanning supply chain is happening. They are rethinking to whether to keep the hubs into the Asia or not. And into that capacity, guys, it has been provided that some of big brands, fine, even they had pulled back their production from Vietnam and had shifted 50% of some of their production to the countries such as the Brazil, Mexico. Okay, now this particular thing is coming. Now guys, which are the new hubs that are emerging? So countries such as the Bulgaria, Ukraine, Romania, Czech Republic, Morocco, Turkey, okay, countries such as the Brazil, etc., they are emerging as a new hubs. Okay, why? Because guys, the Latin America, Brazil, they are near to the USA, and the Turkey, Portugal, the Czech Republic, these are near to the Europe. Europe and the America are the biggest markets. So they are keeping these particular bases near to their home, so that if into the future the crisis happens, they don't need to face such a kind of a problem. Moreover, guys, there is one indirect reason also. See, when the basically consumer is here and when the manufacturer is here, the transportation takes a lot of cost. Today we see that, guys, the crude prices, they have increased a lot. And as the maritime trade happens into the ship and ship uses the fuel, so what has happened, the transportation costs are also increasing, so that the cheap cost advantage that was there, it is now not that much attractive. So therefore, basically, the manufacturing sectors are exiting, or they are exiting out from the Asia. Now guys, into this capacity, it has been provided that companies who are still heavily reliant on to the Vietnam, they are trying to move back. Okay, and the Vietnam this particular year is facing the a deficit into the export to the tune of $5 billion. So this thing is there. So guys, I hope you have understood it, and now we'll move to the next article. Okay, now this particular article has been taken from the Hindu newspaper, and it will be important for the GS paper number 3 under the topic of the role of social media. Now see guys, we have seen, I think yesterday we have taken up an article onto the metaverse, where I have told you the metaverse project that has been launched by the Facebook, and I told you that the metaverse is the idea where a virtual reality will be developed, and into that virtual reality a person will be living a kind of an alternative life where endless opportunities, endless possibilities are there. That is the metaverse's idea that is there. Now guys, yesterday also we have seen some of a criticism, and now one more criticism has been imposed by the Facebook whistleblower. Now guys, the Facebook whistleblower, she few days back said that the Facebook knew this particular thing, that the Instagram is leading to the negative impact onto the teenagers' mental health, but Facebook did not did anything. Now the same whistleblower, she had said that even the idea of the metaverse of the Facebook is wrong. If they had said that the Facebook will that this metaverse will be more addictive and it will rob people of their personal information. Okay, now guys, you are playing PUBG. Why you play PUBG? Because into the PUBG, when you are killing basically your opponents and all these kind of things, you feel a sense of satisfaction, you feel a sense of personal achievement. So what is happening, teenagers, okay, they are addicted to this PUBG game. Now when the meta world will be there, alternative world will be there, where you are into a kind of a different realm, that particular thing also will become addicted, and by that particular thing people's productivity etc. will get declined. Moreover guys, when you will be entering into that particular metaverse world, there will be a lot of your personal information that will be asked, there will be a lot of sensors that will be installed into your homes, into your offices, much more permissions will be asked through your gadgets etc. And by that particular thing, what will happen at the end of the day, this particular sensitive information will be misused by the company such as the Facebook. Moreover guys, it has been provided that this particular addiction will make people to unplug from the reality, in which is this actual world, physical world, and that particular thing is not good. Okay, so because of this particular thing, this metaverse is not a right kind of a thing that is being done. So guys, actually what we need to do, we need to bring a proper regulation onto this particular capacity. So guys, already this metaverse article we have discussed yesterday, I hope you have seen it, otherwise you can again take that one. Okay, so that is all guys about this particular article. Apart of that, nothing more is there. So guys, this is all about the newspaper for today. I hope guys that you have understood it, and with this we come to an end. Now guys, we'll be meeting tomorrow. Meanwhile, I believe that you are enjoying the initiative and there is some value addition that is happening into your content. If it is the case, please do hit the like button and please do spread our initiative as it will give us more motivation to come out with more such kind of content. So that is all for